Hi, this is David Green, and today I'm going to talk with you a little bit about the two syntaxes that Sass recognizes, the indented Sass syntax and the sassy CSS syntax SCSS. Maybe the best way to show you the differences between these two syntaxes is to use a very convenient online tool that you should all be aware of. This is the Sassmeister site, created by Jed Foster and Dale Sandy. It's a playground for Sass where you can experiment and try all sorts of different syntaxes and compile them against different versions of Sass, including libsass. So I've set up a playground environment here for Sassmeister that'll let me create some basic CSS out of some Haml and some Sass. For convenience, I'm just going to paste in a little bit of Haml that I've prepared. What I'm doing here is I'm setting up a blog index, which contains a header for blogs and then four articles. And what I'd like to do is create some Sass I'll be using to style them. Now we have a control panel on this site that lets us switch between writing in SCSS syntax or writing in Sass syntax. And for the sake of this presentation, I'm going to start by writing out the Sass for this. So again, going over here to the Sass, I'm going to paste in a couple of variable definitions. And I'm also going to paste in the definitions of some mix-ins that I might use to help define the style for this particular blog. Now, while I've defined a lot of Sass already, you can see that nothing's actually been generated into the compiled CSS because all of these are just definitions. So let's put those styles in now. Okay, so what I've done here is I've defined an indented styled Sass. I've got a blog index, and inside of that, the first thing that I see is a comment. You'll notice that comments are nested in the Sass syntax, and anything indented automatically becomes part of the comment, whereas in the SCSS syntax, the comments are closed manually. Here inside of my blog index, I've defined a couple of rules. For example, I've got a max width of 20 rems, I've got a font family, which is sans serif, and I've got a background for the blog color, and then I've also got this include for the grouped mixin that I've defined above. Now up here, I've defined the grouped mixin using an equal sign, and it's defined with a padding of 0 and 1 rem, and then a margin of 0 auto. And all of those things get generated out appropriately into the blog index as it's defined. And now nested inside of the blog index, I've got this selector that says that only direct descendant articles should have this style applied to them. And the style that I want applied is the included separated mixin. And the separated mixin here defines a padding bottom for each blog element, which is here, and then says only do this to ones that are not the first of type, which means this is the first article, so it should not get the following styles. The other articles will all get these following styles, which is a bordered top, which is dashed, and then a padding top of 1 rem. And you can see that articles which are a direct descendant of a blog index get the padding bottom of 1 rem, and articles which are not the first of type but are a direct descendant of blog index get the border top and the padding top. Now, one of the nice things about the Sassmeister site, particularly for demonstrations like this, is that I can go over here to the control panel and I can say, here's all of this Sass that I've written. I'd like to see it generated as sassy Sass. And the Sassmeister site will go through and convert everything that I've written to sassy Sass syntax. So for example, we can see that the semicolons have been added to all of the variable and mixin declarations. We can see that the brackets have been added. And where we've defined our mixins, we're using the full word mixin instead of just an equal sign. And where we're defining our includes, we're using the full word include instead of just a plus sign. And we can go back and forth easily. What you can see is that the Sass is actually shorter than the SCSS syntax, but some would say that it's also a little bit harder to understand because, for example, this equals sign might not immediately mean I'm defining a mixin to everybody who reads it. Arguably, the biggest advantage to the sassy CSS syntax is that you can take an existing CSS file and just change the extension from CSS to SCSS, and it'll be valid Sass. It'll be compiled correctly by the Sass compiler. Now, because of this, sassy CSS has become much more popular, and most of the examples that you'll see online will be written in sassy CSS. That speaks to another advantage of Sass CSS, which is if you're working on a team with a large number of developers. The indented syntax might be more obscure. It might be harder to find team members who are willing to write in the indented syntax for a team project. There are some people who find the indented syntax frustrating because it enforces indentation using the exact same spacing every time. While this does make for clean code, it can also introduce compiler errors that are difficult to track down unless you're very good at spotting where the spacing is different in your file. Me, I'm old school, and I often use the indented syntax for personal projects. But generally, if I'm working on a team, or if I'm working on a project in the open source community, and I'm expecting a lot of other people to be working on it with me, I'll use the Sassy CSS syntax. It's more familiar to existing CSS developers, and it is convenient to be able to pull in more examples and more sample code from other projects. So there you have it, a quick introduction to Sassy CSS and the indented Sass syntax, and why you might want to choose one over the other. This has been David Green for SitePoint.